sun's all right. Fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away. Oh, glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, bye and bye. I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from the prison walls I've flown, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away. Oh, glory, I'll fly away.
One more time.
Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Hey, man, y'all sang pretty good. I'm not 100% sure what happened to this side of the church, but somebody may need to shower or something. And it's a shame because I put $2,500 under that fourth pew right there and was going to give that away this morning, but you're not here. So welcome to Franklin Baptist Church. It's good to have everybody. Won't you stand? If you're following along in the hymnals, it's 516. If not, boom, there it is.
The trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the saints of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Again, we welcome you to Franklin Baptist Church this morning. It's good to see everybody. Your announcements are in the back of your bulletin. We got Takeaway Tuesday starting back up this Tuesday. Tear. Finally. It seems like it's been a while. Ain't it? There's still a sign-up sheet. There's a new sign-up sheet. Shame on you, whoever took the sign-up sheet last time, but there's a new sign-up sheet in the back for anybody who wants to bring meals. Donations of individual bags, chips, Kool-Aid, Capri Sun, small bottles of water and snack cakes, et cetera. Church-wide ice cream social, sponsored by our women's ministry. Is this so everybody can come to it? And it's sponsored by, see, there, everybody can come. Even the men can come to the ice cream social. I just want to make sure I don't want to get kicked out or nothing when I got in there. Donations be accepted to support Eastern Elementary. We've got, in the back, I've got hearing devices. If you have a lot of trouble hearing during the service, I've got four hearing devices that you can use, okay? I know sometimes If you need one right now, there's one right up front here. Debbie will throw it at you. She's a pretty good shot. But she's got one up here that she'll give to you. All you got to do is turn it on, turn it up. Turn it up as loud as you want to, and you'll be able to hear it. I've got four of them. Also in the nursery. We've had this back there forever, but a lot of times the nursery, there's nobody in there. There's a speaker in there. And that speaker will, you'll hear everything that's going on out here. All you got to do is turn it up, okay? So if you know somebody that's working the nursery or in the nursery, you can go back there and you won't miss anything. I'm preaching today, so if you want to leave it off, it's fine. I understand. Youth lock-in, 6 to 12, 12th grade only, September 15th, 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. If you're going to go, please get in touch with Candance and Ebony for permission slips that have to be signed for them to be able to go, okay? Is there anything else? Am I missing something? Socks. Yeah, I got socks on. Oh, socks. Why don't you stand up and tell everybody? Yeah, come on, Candance, because I can't remember what you text me now. Y'all know you got some of them big, tall socks with the yellow stripes or there's something on them. You know you got some laying around somewhere. Don't act like you don't. I know I still got a couple pair of them. So. Trying to think. It seems like there was something else I was going to tell you. If I think about it, I'll tell you later. Got any birthdays or anniversaries? What? That must be where all them people are. That's it. Birthday or anniversary? Really, Olivia? Get that hearing device and take it back here. When is your birthday? Tomorrow. All right, well, let's all stand and sing happy birthday to Olivia. Turn back to your seats.
page 316 in your hymnal. Just as soon as Debbie gets back to her, I ain't picking on Peggy, she hurt me. Struggling this morning, folks. I'm wanting to do that, and I told Amy, I said, I'll give you a break this morning, I'll do the clicker thing. Well, my hand wants to do this, this one's holding the Bible, and my mouth just ain't wanting to say the words that are coming out, so. And that's a hymnal. But I do know this.
Yeah.
It's good to see y'all this morning. I hope you have a safe trip back home. But I do know this. I can this morning say, what page, Bob?
445.
There it was. I missed that last week. I didn't get hit by a deer. We're going to get to that here in just a minute. Sweet Hour of Prayer, 445.
Call my Lord.
We ask now that you please prepare your hearts for worship. Thank you, Becky. That's beautiful. Always is beautiful. She'll take a look through our prayer list. Want to add a couple to that, or one in particular. This morning, found out Steve Rogers had a motorcycle accident involving a deer hitting him right in the side. He has two breaks in his leg, and how on earth he didn't come flying off that motorcycle, I'll never know, but God was surely looking down on him, but he's in an extreme amount of pain. Many of you know Steve don't usually let the grass grow beneath his feet. He stays up and going pretty well, so be in prayer for him. I know he's supposed to hopefully go get to a doctor tomorrow, maybe, if he can. Surgery tomorrow. Be with him. Yeah, that the deer didn't make it. And from what I hear, somebody stopped and got the deer and didn't ask Steve how he was doing. So it always kind of pours some salt in the wound, don't it? Yeah, but he's doing okay. He's going to have surgery. Continue to remember Marvin. Of course, many of you know Marvin's tractor caught on fire. And I've said it 100,000 times, and I'll keep saying it. That is the toughest individual that ever walked on the face of this earth. But he had pretty much no choice but to jump off that tractor. I know a lot of you had asked, you know, well, why on earth did he jump? He didn't have no choice. He had to get off of it. But, you know, Marvin, I haven't got to talk to him. I talked to Lynn a couple times, and he's tough. He's just tough. So the surgery that he was going to be having, they postponed it until he kind of gets better. From this, so keep him and LaVon in your prayers. Again, our church family: Joe Brewer, Logan DeWitt, Helen Irwin, Steve Highshoe, Kathy LaFollette, the family of Mike Mount. Had his services yesterday, and it was full military burial service. If you've never experienced that, wow. It's just absolutely gorgeous, and yesterday was probably one of the best ones that I've ever seen. It was very fitting because Mike was deeply loved by his family and friends. So continue to keep them in your thoughts and prayers. Colton Nichols, Barbara Parks, Gina Perryman, Bobby Sharp, Bobby's Gwen. And you know, we really, really, really need to lift Gwen up in our prayers and just for strength and comfort at this time. Ray and Elaine Whitaker and Lucas and our mama to be, Jordan. Let's go to prayer. Heavenly Father, we bring this to you every week, Lord, and I know throughout the week we ask for your guidance and we try to remember everybody, Lord, but I ask now that even those that were not spoken of today, Lord, that you reach out and place your loving hand over them and so many that are missing family members right now, that are missing those lost and loved ones that have gone on, and I pray, Lord, that you be with them and guide and direct them. And just take us through this service and just help us to remember why we're here, Lord. And we're here to worship you and give you all the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Today's scripture, I'm playing a little trick on y'all. Y'all opened your eyes and thought I was there, didn't you? Yeah. Today's scripture comes from Colossians chapter 3, 23 through 25. So whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for their wrongs, and there is no favoritism. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Now, I'm going to do this song today, and it's one that I did in the service yesterday. It's one you all have heard 50 million times, probably, but as I was writing this sermon out today, or last week, this song just kept speaking to me, and I hope it does to you too.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, and I am worn. Through the storms, through the night, lead me on. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home. Hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home.
It's one of my all-time favorites, I think. I say that about every one of them. They're all my favorites. So today we're going to look at a character from the Bible that is not a real common one. I'll say that. It's from Ruth chapter 1, verse 1 through 5. It says, in the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife, two sons, went to live for a while and in the country of Moab. The man's name was Elimelech, his wife's name Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem, Judah, and they went to Moab and lived there. Now, Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons, and they married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. After they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband. Elimelech from the book of Ruth, and some are sitting here thinking, darn, that's all they said about him. We're going to get out of here early. First off, shame on you for wanting to get out early. Secondly, there's always something more to it the deeper you dig. So today I want to focus on a word that nobody likes, and that's consequences. Nobody likes that word. Consequences also leads to another word that we don't like, and that would be accountability. Yet another one that makes us feel attacked every single time we hear it. And there are consequences to every single action that we make in our lives. If you hit the snooze button for an hour, don't throw nothing at me. If you hit the snooze button for an hour and you live 20 minutes from work and you wake up 15 minutes before you got to go to work, guess what? You're going to be late, right? And if your boss knows about it, there's going to be some consequences. Today's scripture paints a whole uglier picture of the consequences that happen. Eternal consequences for some. The actions of this man had such a negative impact on his family because of one choice that he made. There was a famine in the land. There was you know, not quite enough food to go around to make everybody feel comfortable, and he chose to take matters into his own hands instead of trusting God. That one singular decision brought down a spiral of just horrible events that impacted each member of his family. And we've heard Brother Jackie mention the quote that's attributed to Kay Arthur, a well-known Christian author, saying, sin will take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you far more than what you want to pay. And this story illustrates exactly that. Here we have a man whose family lives in the promised land, lives in the land, Bethlehem, Judah. And as we said here in the first verse, there's a famine, there's a shortage of food. But it also tells us that this was the time of judges. And at the end of Judges, in verse 25, it says, in those days Israel had no king. So everyone did as he saw fit. It speaks of a time of lawlessness, adultery, false religions, theft, drunkenness, sexual perversion, violence, and a national division. Guess what? You don't have to turn on the news now because I just told you everything you're going to hear today. The world we live in today is a time where men and women do what's right in our own eyes. And I personally believe that that is a consequence of the teachings of the church. We come in here, and not all churches, but eventually every church is guilty of it. Jackie hit on it last week. Some churches are more concerned about putting butts in the seats and how many we can go to lunch that day when we see other people that's going to El Nepal to eat lunch and say, how many did you have today? Oh, we have around 80, 90, 100. Had just about the same amount last week. We're building. It's the same conversation you have every single time. We're building. We're getting back to it. And we're more concerned about how many people come through the door than how many souls were actually led to Jesus Christ. We're more concerned about, I like how Jackie always says it, tickling the ears. You're tickling the ears. I heard this morning, does anybody else listen to WHAS in the morning, 84? Ed Balsman. Ed Bousman gets on there and he does it every Sunday. I listen to it every Sunday morning. It's right when I'm coming to church. And he said that your ears get itchy and they need to be scratched. You need to hear something good. And churches want to look like a loving church, which is all good and fine. But let me ask you this. Does that church truly love you if you walk through that door and just tells you what you want to hear and tells you what they want you to hear so you'll come back? Or do you expect to be loved when you come in the church and be told what God wants you to do? What does God ask of us? Not what we want. What does God want? But a lot of churches will let you walk through the door and then they'll say, it's okay, go back out there and do what you were doing, and then just as long as you come back next Sunday. That's on the church. And if they don't tell you about the consequences of living in the sin that you lived in before you walked through the door, then that's not a loving church. And they figure, just come in this building, give us your tithes, and all is forgiven. Because, hey, you're trying, right? You're trying. You're giving it your best. And last time I checked, that is not how scripturally that works. Not even close. Every sin has a consequence. And yes, if you're living in sin, because guess what? We all are. I don't care who you are. We're living in it. You're in the right place. This is where you need to be. But coming in here and just singing some hymns and listening to the preacher and then go back to it is not how it works. In chapter 5, when Jesus healed the man who had been an invalid for 38 years, I'm pretty sure he didn't say, take up your mat and go do what you did before you come in here because I just wiped it clean. You're good to go. You read on further in chapter 8 in John, I'm pretty sure when the young lady was caught in the act of adultery and the teachers, the Pharisees, they got together and they were going to stone her. Yeah, Jesus put them in their place, but I'm pretty sure he didn't say, hey, you just go on back to doing what you're doing. It's okay. Jesus said, sin no more. You are forgiven, but sin no more. Here in this particular story, we see a consequence of God's people turning on him. See, in the Old Testament, we see it many times. Throughout the Old Testament, we see God would send a famine to their lands as a means of discipline. And this family, they were right in the middle of those times. They lived in Bethlehem, Judah. Bethlehem in Old Hebrew means house of bread. And Judah means praise. They were living in a place that God had designed for them. Yet, he decided to hightail it out of there as soon as the first little bit of trouble showed its face. Man, that sounds familiar. And he went to a city called Moab. Now, in Psalms 108:9, God describes Moab as his washpot. I don't know, and in olden days, you know, they used to wash feet a lot. You know what that water looked like after they've been walking around on dirt and everything else all day? Probably pretty nasty, right? So Moab was his washpot. It was known as a filthy place. And even though there was a famine in the land, he never thought, man, maybe I should just stay and trust God. No, the first thought was, I got to get out of here. We can take care of it. We got it. And you can see that it didn't work out too well. Elimelech passes, and so does his two sons. Instead of trusting God, he took off. Where he was at, he could worship God at the temple. He could bring his offerings to God. He could keep the feasts that they were commanded by in law. But in Moab, he and his family went to pretty much a godless land. He took his family into a much worse condition because of fear that God didn't have his back. Folks, when we face tough times, we make those knee-jerk reactions. We have the same reaction. God, sometimes we don't do it by accident either. Sometimes we know what God wants, and yet we still go the opposite way, completely disobeying him and on our own. We may have faced the tough times and walked away from God, and folks, when you do that, you go to that wicked place. It doesn't have to be intentional. But that's where you end up every single time, and that's what happened to his family. And I can't tell you, you can argue with God all you want to, and you can try to do it on your own. This week I was in Western Kentucky for about 3 days. Internet connection was horrible. I was trying to do my schoolwork. I was putting together a sermon. And the guy that was giving the lecture, the professor, it was real glitchy. So he, I did that till 1:30 in the morning Thursday night. I was like, man, this is horrible. But the whole time I was writing this sermon out, I thought, I read this passage and I said, I'm going to do that. If I can make a sermon out of that one guy, man, that'd be cool, wouldn't it? A whole sermon out of this. One day he's only got a paragraph there. That can't be that bad, can it? Well, I got to doing the sermon and I said, I'm kind of one of those. I don't want to get up here and I don't want to be negative. And me and Jackie have argued about a negative sermon. If he gave one I thought was negative, I was like, man, that's a little harsh, wasn't it? He said, what am I doing? I get it now. I tried to put pen to paper after I changed my mind. I was going to do something else. Sat there like this for an hour, and I said, okay, fine, I give up. I hate being negative, and I'm not. This isn't negative, but I like happy things. I do like to hear a little ear-tickling sermon every once in a while. I want to feel good about myself. But that's what happens when you don't want to hear what God has to say. Severe consequences for sinful choices don't just affect us. It affects everyone around us. And the bad thing is, and it doesn't matter what it is, it could be drug use, addiction to anything, or just plain old everyday lying. Little lies that you told you couldn't even remember you told. It all affects the ones closest to us. But when you live in that wicked place, when you turn away from God, and when you go away on your own, the other people around you tend to not matter as much, because it's all about you. It's all about me. And if we look again, Elimelech's, he had a wife named Naomi, two sons. And if you would have asked him, he would have told you that he made the best move for his family. But by the time this short passage is up, we see that he was completely wrong. Both sons are dead and Naomi is devastated. Things got rough and he made a decision to go, to flee the place that God had given him. I cannot tell you that enough. God had made this place for them and he chose to go to a wretched land which was basically godless. We look at that and we say, well, why'd he do that? Why would he do it? And I ask you, are we really that different from him? Is there really that much of a difference? Because some of us have professed faith in God, and then as soon as we're faced with some kind of tough decision, we abandon him. Maybe you came in here one Sunday, and I've had this conversation, so I know it's true. You come in here one Sunday and somebody just plain ticked you off. You didn't like what somebody had to say, and you said, I ain't going back there. Maybe it came in here and somebody was sitting in your seat. Don't act like it don't happen, because it does. Well, I ain't going back in there. They don't even like me enough to save my seat. Or maybe you came in here and you heard something that you just didn't agree with, or something that might have stung a little bit, and you don't want to come back. Folks, if that's the reason you came in here was to make everybody else around you happy, then you came here for the wrong reason. You didn't come here to hear the word of God. You didn't come here to try to get your life straight. You didn't come here to try and hear the truth of the gospel. You came here for everybody else. And that's not what God wants. I feel extremely blessed that God don't act like us. I can almost... It's almost like you can see God standing in the corner going, I made them in my image, but whoo-wee, they sure don't act like me. But that's when you say, thank you, Jesus, for loving us, no matter how ignorant we can be. No matter how we act and how many times we give up on it. Many have walked away and taken their lives in their own hands, and instead of making things better, it got a whole lot worse, and that's what Elimelech did. His family became like the Moabites, showing us that if you remain out in the world, you will become the world. Let me say that again. If you remain out in the world, you will become the world. One-on-one, you just against one other person that absolutely despises what you do and how you live, as far as you're loving the Lord, you probably stand a pretty good chance. You surround yourself with a bunch of people that are trying to drag you down and are trying to drag you away from God, your chances of winning decrease a whole lot. A whole lot. Because we tend to forget, when we accept Jesus Christ into our heart, we have the Spirit of the power of the Holy Spirit. We have the power to say no. We have the power to say, sin, I don't want it. But we forget that because we turn away from God. And the moment trouble hits, it's just a whole lot easier to go along with the crowd. The people you surround yourself with has consequences. And I absolutely despised that growing up because I heard it a million times. Boy, one you're hanging out with, I'm telling you now, it ain't going to turn out well. And I instantly went, who you think you are? You don't know. Me and my Uncle Bobby Brown had many, many arguments. And he always had me because I had to cut tobacco and stuff for him. So he knew he had me. And we'd have long conversations. Boy, you need to quit hanging around with him. It wasn't the fact that he didn't particularly like them. He just knew the path they were going to take me down. And he knew me well enough to know I was going to go right along with them. And it's a hard fact, a hard pill to swallow. And you learn the hard way that sin will take you farther than you want to go. You know, as the leader of this family, he died so his family had to pick up the pieces without him. And his sons, who were already knee-deep in a wicked culture at Moab, chose to marry women from Moab. Now, this was a direct violation of the Mosaic law. Fun fact, anybody that doesn't know that law, that was the law of the land. The law was passed down to Moses from God. And keep in mind, this is the Old Testament. This is under the Old Covenant. Okay, this is, but Jesus' spirit was here, but physically he was not yet. So this was under the old law. So they were 10 years of sinfully violating all that God said was bad. But folks, if you're truly saved by the Holy Spirit, he'll let you know. When you're moving away, you'll know. And that's what makes it even worse, is the fact that you know you're walking away from God. It's not an accident. You know that you're walking away. And the Holy Spirit will convict you of your sins and reveal to you that it's time to come back. And the bad thing is, like I said, we know we're backsliding, but yet we keep right on trucking. And if you think there aren't consequences for that, eternal consequences, then you're wrong. I'm here to tell you you're wrong. And I have no doubt most people, and a lot here today, full intentions of making things right eventually. And that's the word that can get you in trouble every time, is eventually. I'll do that. Why not put off till tomorrow what you can do today? You know, eventually I'll get there. Well, eventually sometimes never comes. And then it's too late. Because if you don't take the steps to get back to God when you know you need to get back to God, then there will be a price to pay. And not only will sin take you farther than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay, but it'll cost you way more than you're wanting to pay. Naomi saw that in this story. Husband died. Both sons died. Now her and her two daughters-in-law were left desolate. In that society, the poorest of the poor were widows with no children to care for them. So these women were left with nothing but discouragement and defeat. And the consequences were severe. And sadly, this could have all been taken care of if that one decision hadn't been made to turn away from God. Because one bad decision breeds another, and breeds another. every single time. And you'll notice that Elimelech didn't jump right into sin. And we're not told that he worshipped idols. He didn't get involved in the adultery. He wasn't a thief or a murderer. From all accounts, he was a pretty good guy. Because a lot of times we think, well, you know, that guy's no good. I know where he's going. What about the good guy? Is it automatic that you know, well, Jesus loves him. He's pretty good. He does pretty good. Jesus loves you, but there's accountability. There's accountability. And you're the problem here is he was willing to walk away from God to take care of his family. And folks, this is the part that always stings the worst. I love my family. I love being a dad. I love my children. I love my wife and cannot imagine this world without them. But if you don't make God first in your life above everything else, it doesn't say make God above whatever you want to make him above. Make God above everything else. And that's what this man failed to see. He put his family first, walked away from God, and you see what happens in the rest of the story. He was literally a man whose name meant, God is my king. But he didn't trust God enough to provide for him, and in the midst of the troubling time, so he took it into his own hands, and the consequences were severe. And one of the saddest parts of the story is to see how simple the solution was to not allow it to happen. We come up here every week and we give you 20, 25 minutes of a sermon. We try to make it different every week. We try to do things differently every time. We try to make a service different every single time. When the only thing that we have to do is give our hearts to God and listen to Him. That's all. That is it. Because you know what happens when you give your heart to God? We talked about it in Sunday school this morning. There's a lot of people that do a lot of good things in this world. There's a lot of people that do a lot of bad things. I think the good still outshines the bad. But at the end of the day, that good does you no good. It's useless. It's worthless at the end of the day if your heart's not in it. If your heart is not there and you're just doing it to get the attention, you're just doing it so somebody will look at you and say, "Whoo-wee, Franklin's on fire, man. People are loading into the pews." No good whatsoever. But if your heart belongs to God and you truly love Him and you truly welcome Him in, then the good deeds will follow and you'll never think twice about it. That's how that works. And that's how easy it would have been for this family to turn around and say, "I'm going to go back home where God wants me." But it didn't turn out that way. But amidst all this bad news that his family had to endure and all I've subjected you to this morning, there is good news. There's glorious news. There's wonderful news that God still loves us. He still loves you. He still waits with open arms when we finally decide it's time to go back. He's waiting. And yeah, there's times I can stand up here and preach happy, happy, happy. And I'm telling y'all, I was on the struggle bus this week with this one. But I'd rather do that every single time than to know that somebody walked out here and thought differently. My love for you and this church goes way farther than that fuzzy feeling you get when you hear a happy sermon. I want us all to enjoy the beauty that awaits us. I was at a service for a man yesterday that I know where he's at. But I've also been to ones that I didn't have no idea where they were at. And I don't want any single person that hears me here, hears me online, anywhere to know any different. God loves you, but there are consequences if you don't turn to Him and if you turn away from Him. Don't let the consequences of your decisions today take you away from God and a God that loves you. Hit your knees at the altar You can come take my hand. If you don't want, if anything, call one of us. Reach out. Talk to God. And let him know that you're ready to make your way back. Won't you pray with me? Heavenly Father, there are times that and things that we just don't want to hear sometimes, and sometimes there's mixed emotions. Lord, there is one thing that is constant, and that is your love. That is your love for us. But Lord, I just pray so much daily that if there's a heart that needs to be softened so that you can enter it, if there's a time and an opportunity that you can place one of us, anybody, in front of somebody else and help lead them back to you or lead them to you for the first time, Lord, I pray that you just give us the wisdom and the knowledge and the words to say. There are many that think heaven is full and that hell is empty. And Lord, I know that that is not the case. But I want every single person possible to go see Jesus' face, to go wrap their arms around his neck one day, and to go see their family members, and to go be where you want them to be. But Lord, we know that starts with us. So I pray that you continue to guide us. I pray that you continue to direct us in the path that we should go. It's in your heavenly name I pray. Amen.